Right. So once again, welcome to this program and hearty congratulations to the organizers. I'm very happy that the principal made some very valid points in his opening remarks. He talked about what the problem is and where the cause lies and what could be some possible solutions to help this situation, and also told us directly and indirectly why this college has taken this initiative to organize this program. So the right note has been struck, and I would like to take off from there. The topic that has been suggested by Dr. Narayanamurthy is teaching English as a second language. So we have been talking about quite a lot of other topics, technology, tools, and many, many other things that have been happening in the modern times. But going back to something very basic, I think is the need of the hour. So how second language, English as second language, is being taught today? What are some problems and what are some possibilities? Are there any possible solutions that we can think of? So this is the topic that has been suggested. I'm very happy whoever has coined this title and whoever has thought of this subject. I'm very happy that you have suggested this. Okay, I have decided to present this in four parts. Four components in my presentation. I'd like to very briefly deal with the differences between English as first language and English as second language. I don't think I need to spend much time there because you're all English lecturers and you know what exactly I mean to tell you at this point. Then some problems of teaching English as second language at graduate level. I think I need to disable this one moment. Please give me a moment. I think somebody is using the tools. I think I've disabled it. I'll also need to edit them. One second, please. I know this happens these days. Quite a lot of students are teacher students are, yeah, a little mischievous. And the moment the program begins, they would like to disrupt the program somehow or the other, or they would like to try their drawing skills perhaps. So some of them are very, very young drawing students, I think. I'm happy anyway. So now you cannot do that. I've disabled you. Right. The second thing is, so the problems of teaching English as a second language. And then the third part, of course, is the most important part for me and for you. So some possibilities, we'll explore some possibilities, some solutions, what we can do to help ourselves. See, because we have a problem, we need to identify the solution ourselves, and we need to begin using that solution ourselves, and we need to begin finding outcomes ourselves. And that's why, so my focus is point number three, component number three. And finally, if we have time left, some offline and online tools that we have to help us become better teachers of English as second language. Before I continue, I'd like to ask Mr. Narayanamurthy or somebody there to tell me, because the brochure says that this program closes at 1 o'clock, but I don't know if there are any other speakers or what exactly is the plan. What time should I stop? Sir? Dr. Narayanamurthy?
Sir, please.
What time do you want me to stop?
Sir, it is your wish, sir.
Oh, thank you so much. Something very similar happened recently. I went to a program. I was asked to speak about some technical subject. And then before I began, I asked the organizers, so how long do I have? And then how much time to have? And this gentleman was very clever. And he told me, sir, you can go as long as you want. No problem at all. But we are leaving at 1 o'clock. So I'm sure that would happen today also. So I think the schedule says that this program closes at 1 o'clock. Maybe what I think is maybe about 15, 20 minutes or half an hour before I'll close. After that, we can have an interaction. It does not mean that you have to wait with your questions till the end of the program. You can always raise your hand in the chat box, or you can ask your questions in the chat box. And in case you want, you can have your even videos on, but microphones switched off. And in case you have a question, you can ask me at any point of time. In fact, that's the whole purpose. I don't want to hold you till the end of the program in case you have any questions. But maybe I cannot see your questions directly. I cannot see your hand raised also directly. Perhaps somebody will help me in case there is any relevant question, either Dr. Narayana Murthy or Mrs. Kamala Kusuma or somebody in the department, somebody in the college will stop me and ask me that question. They'll read out the question to me and we can continue. Right. So are you all with me? How many parts are there in this presentation? I cannot hear you, but you can say that. I'll imagine that I have heard you. How many parts are there in that? 4, right? Which is the most important part of my presentation? The third one, right? The third one is my focus, possibilities, solutions, something that we can try at our level to improve the situation. Okay, let's move on to the first one. So the first part is English as a first language and English as a second language. Are there any differences? If there are differences, what are they? There's no point in spending any time on this because I think you're all lecturers. You've been teaching English for quite some time and I don't want you to make primary school students and tell you the differences. I don't need a chart and all that. And I don't need to go into too many basic factors that distinguish learning first language and learning second language. So learning, I'm emphasizing the word learning. Learning a language as a first language, as a native language, as a local language, and learning a second language, a foreign language, right? Something that is not naturally acquired. So typically, second language is acquired at a later stage. It is not native to us. It's not the language that we speak at home. And this is quite challenging to learn. And it demands a lot of effort, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So you can think of many reasons. I don't need to go into that. And then that would be, I think, a waste of time because, I mean, it's something known to you and known to me. And that's why there's no point in talking about this slide any longer. At any point, you can take a screenshot or you can make notes. You can have a scribbling pad with you. And in case you want to ask a question at the end, you can make notes and then you can reserve them or you can immediately stop me also, as I told you. My focus today is not the differences between learning English as first language and learning English as second language. So the focus is the differences between teaching English as first language and teaching English as second language. I think you've heard the difference. And we are not interested in the differences between learning English as first or second language, but we are interested in knowing the differences between teaching English as first language and second language. Somebody has the microphone on in the college. I think either Venkateshwarlu or somebody has the microphone on. Please mute yourself so that it'll be easier for me. My voice will be audible better. Okay, so the focus is on finding out and resolving the problems, the differences between teaching, not learning, teaching English as first language, teaching English as a second language. I'm not teaching English as a first language anyway, unless English is my mother tongue, and unless I work in a culture or a country or a geographical area where English is spoken by everybody, where English is learned by children right from their infancy. So then I become a teacher of English as first language. I am not in that situation. So that does not perhaps concern me. Then what does concern me? I am a teacher of English where English is not spoken. I am an English teacher in a college where students don't speak English naturally, not as a mother tongue. And I teach English in a place where English environment does not exist. Right? Students don't have much opportunity to interact with English speaking people and in English speaking contexts. And I perhaps am a loner. I am alone. So I have to make my own way. So that is the situation in which we have to teach English. So there is a lot of difference between a teacher who teaches English in an environment where English is naturally acquired, in fact, that teacher has very little work because Telugu also, no? Maybe it's a higher level and it's a different environment altogether, like teaching a mother tongue. But teaching English is a much different task. So that's what we are discussing today. Okay, let's quickly go on to what are the problems that teachers have. Here, my presentation begins. Problems of teaching English as a second language, right? So what are these problems? Okay, I'll wait here for a moment. Dr. Narayana Murthy sent you a registration form. The registration form had some questions also. Apart from asking you to fill out your name, your mobile number, your email address, the college where you are working, and some other details, etc., etc., he also asked you a question. What was the question? Do you remember? I'm showing it to you on the screen. This was the exact question, word to word, that he asked you in the form. The question was, mention any one of the problems that you faced while teaching English as a second language. I'll come to your answers in the next slide, but let me read that question again. Mention any one of the problems that you faced while teaching English as a second language. So, as an English teacher, okay. I mean, more than the problem itself that you're going to talk about, I am interested in the wording of this question and answer that's expected. The question is, mention one. So, if I give no answers at all, or if I give more than one answer, maybe I have not understood the question, maybe, as an English teacher. And instead of talking about problems, suppose I begin giving suggestions, perhaps not, I've not understood the question. Suppose I give problems that are not related to teaching English as a second language, but I talk about general problems. Problems that are, I mean, common to all teaching any subject. Right? My college does not have a building. Suppose somebody writes that. So it's not relevant to teaching English language. It is relevant to all subjects, wherever, whatever you are teaching. So in case my answer does not perfectly fit the question that I'm answering, so there is a problem there. What is the problem? Either I have not understood the question, right? That's very difficult to accept, right? And sometimes, perhaps, maybe the teacher did not frame the question properly. Not in this case. In this case, the question is framed absolutely perfectly. Okay, coming back to this. So the question was, mention any one of the problems that you faced while teaching English as a second language. Let me just show you the data that he and I collected. So this was the Google form that was sent to you, and these are the answers that you gave. How many of you? So when we downloaded this, 223 people, right, used it, and then they gave. So this is your name, your college, and the answer that you gave. So without, I mean, spending time on this, let me go back here to the slideshow, and let me tell you what I wanted to tell you. Right. When this question was included in the data form that was sent to you, the Google form that was sent to you, believe me, I've showed you the Excel sheet. You can also take it back from Narayana Murthy if you want. 30% of those who filled out the form did not write anything. They left it blank. 30%. Right? Maybe if he had made answering the question compulsory, unless you answer that question, you cannot move, you cannot submit the form, perhaps you'd have written something there. But he did not do that in good faith that you give some answer. So if 30% people who fill the form did not give any answer, the purpose of the survey is lost. Suppose your students do not answer you. You ask a question and 30% students do not participate, do not respond, do not give any reply. What is your complaint? My students don't open their mouths, sir. My students don't answer questions, sir. My students don't understand my question, sir. This is the typical complaint. Okay, let's leave these 30%. Another 25% of you, surprisingly, and very fortunately, maybe very happily, they said, no. The question was, mention any one of the problems that you faced while teaching. No. No is one, it's a bad answer. It's a bad grammar. If the question is mentioned any one, because it refers to a number, if you wanted to say no, you had to say none or no problems. Okay, so again, that was the second thing. I mean, I'm not blaming any English teacher because there were many other subject teachers also. I think maybe some non-teachers and some students also may be participating. I'm just telling you, my focus is on finding out the problems, why problems occur, not blaming anybody. Okay, that was the second thing. Then coming to the others, many of them, maybe about another 25-30% of you made comments and suggested problems that are not very specific to teaching English as second language. Lack of furniture, for instance, somebody said that. Lack of furniture is not exclusively relevant to teaching English language. It's a problem, that's all. It's a class problem. It's an infrastructural problem. Of course, lack of furniture affects the quality of English teaching in the class. I don't know what furniture you have in mind. Suppose you do not have a blackboard in the class. That certainly is a problem for any teacher. But we naturally, when he made this question, Dr. Narayanamurthy did not have that kind of problems in mind. He did not expect them. Okay, let's move on. Maybe you will understand what I wanted to say better if you see the next slide. These are the answers that you gave. I left out all the blank answers. I left out all the wrong, bad answers, no answers, zero answers, etc., etc. And these are the answers. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, some 7 or 8 columns of them, many of them. So your name is here. And what you wrote, for instance, somebody said pronunciation is the problem. Somebody said regarding poetry, etc. I mean, some good things, right? Some nearly about 70 of you, 80 of you gave reasonably good answers. Okay, what have I done with that? I did not tell Dr. Narayanamurthy what I was going to do with this. He does not know what I am doing with this till this moment. So I only requested him to send me the data and he sent it to me. And I spent almost 2 hours analyzing this data. I read almost every one of your answers. Every one of your answers. And what I did is finally, I created a new slide for myself. When I looked at the answers a little more closely, I realized that you have problems like this. Students come from Telugu medium background. They come from rural background. Students lack motivation. Students lack basic language skills, basic communication skills. The right environment is not there. Students have inhibitions. The principal also made this statement. Students are inhibitions, diffidence, etc. Mother tongue influence is there. Absenteeism is a big problem. Lack of technology is a problem. Large and heterogeneous classes are a problem. And English, sometimes the kind of English that we expect them to learn is not an examination task. And students have problems with listening, speaking, reading, writing, and pronunciation, etc., etc., individually. This is a consolidated list of the answers that you give. It consolidated your own answers. I think I've not excluded any. Every one of the answers that you gave fit into these things. Right? Maybe you put it in different words, but I've summarized that. Now, when I ask myself, are these really problems of teaching? Because the topic that's given to me is problems of teaching English as a second language, not problems of learning English as a second language. I'm not looking at it from the student's point of view. I am looking at our point of view. As teachers, what problems do you have? Are these our problems? In a way, yes. Okay, to some extent, yes. Students do not know or do not have basic communication skills. That's why I am appointed. Why are English lecturers appointed in colleges? Why am I paid a salary? Because students cannot speak English. Suppose I can speak good English, why am I needed? Tomorrow I lose my job. Suppose all my students speak brilliant English. They are outstanding. Maybe I don't need to work there. I have to think of some other job. My students, for instance, another problem, absenteeism. My students don't come to class at all. Who is asking you to worry about those who have not come? We are asking you to help those who come to the class. If 10 students come to your class, what can we do? How can we help these 10 students is the issue. And I don't understand, this is a kind of a paradox. So on one hand, people say absenteeism. On the other hand, they say large classes. Sir, classes are 100 big, 200 big. I have to handle 120 students, sir. How can I teach English? Well, the same teacher 10 minutes later says, sir, students don't come to class at all, sir. Not even 10% students come to class, sir. If 10% of 120 students come to class, what problem do you have? Right? So, we just give answers, perhaps not very seriously, maybe without analyzing the problem. Not because we want to evade, not because we want to escape, not because we want to avoid facing the situation. I don't look at it from that point of view. I'm not blaming anyone. What I'm telling you is, we have not learned the skill of analyzing a problem. I think you've understood, right? If you've not given an answer to that question, no problem, right? If you have given an answer like this, have you analyzed the problem properly? The question was, any one of the problems that you faced as a teacher of English teaching second language, English as second language. 90% of the problems that I have listed there are not teaching problems. Maybe they are learning problems. Maybe they are environment problems. Maybe they are infrastructural problems. Maybe they are problems, social, cultural, maybe 100 different kinds, right? But are they relevant to me as a teacher? Okay, maybe I'll give you an example to help you understand that. Suppose somebody says the textbook is bad. It's a useless textbook designed by some headless fellows and they've sat somewhere in the university. They don't know the real problems of our college and they don't know the quality of the students that I get. So they created a textbook and have thrust it at us, and that's why we have to teach this textbook and bad textbook. That's why I can't teach English language. My students can't learn English language. Okay, I agree. This is a real problem. But my question is, can I do anything about it? Can I change the textbook? Why worry over something that I cannot change? Absenteeism is a big problem. The principal will take care of that. That's not your problem. Absenteeism is a principal's problem, parents' problem, society's problem, government's problem. Right? It's not an examination task. It's a university's problem. The university has to think how to redesign the examination pattern to ensure that students really learn English. I think you are following me. In case you have any questions, you can raise your hands. Somebody will read out the question and stop me. Right. So what I'm telling you is, don't worry about the things you cannot change. There are a lot more wonderful, useful things that we can worry about and we can change. There is a saying, I think you might have heard of that, what cannot be cured must be endured. What cannot be cured must be endured. I cannot change my textbook, endure it. I cannot change the classroom environment, endure it. I cannot change the social, economic, cultural background of my student. Is that possible to me? Your governments are not able to do that. What will you do? There's no point in complaining, no? Sir, my students are very poor. They don't even have chappals to wear. They don't have good clothes. Sir. They just come to college and then they want to spend some time here. That's a big, huge problem somebody else will address. Our responsibility as an English teacher is, during these 2 years that the student is with me, his English speaking skills, her English speaking skills must improve. If I have done that, I am the greatest teacher in the world. So when he came to the class in the beginning, BSc, BA, BCom, a student has joined on the first day, how was their English? And 2 years later, if I teach them for 2 years, 1 year later, if I teach them only for 1 year, at the end of that year, first year, second year, whatever, if students are able to speak better English, I think I pat myself on my back and say, okay, wonderful. I have done a great work. I'm not worried about other things. The students have not come to college. I'm not worried about that. Right? The lack of furniture, somebody else is taking care of that. A bad textbook, somebody else is taking care of that. I don't mean to say again that you should not do anything about those problems that cannot be cured. If you can do something, do it. Suppose you can write a letter to the university, the academic body that designs the curriculum, that designs the textbook, administers the examination, write to them, or maybe go and speak there in appropriate forums and do that. That's a different, perspective altogether. Okay, let me come to this one last sentence on this slide. Dr. Ashok Kumar Vemula, I don't know where he works, maybe Tirupati, I think. If he is here, I request him to just switch on his microphone and come online. Dr. Ashok Kumar Vemula, he is the one, I like this answer, that's why I'm highlighting that. He said, lack of appropriate methodology, only one in the entire 170-200 answers that I received in that form, one person wrote, lack of appropriate methodology. Is Dr. Ashok Kumar Vemula here? Will you please raise your hand if you're there? I don't think. He's not there. Okay, so he said, lack of appropriate methodology. Even there is a small problem. It's not lack of, because methodology is not available or unavailable. It's used or unused, that's all. What is it? Should there be something? Is it something physical? Methodology is not some physical matter, no? Somebody has raised a hand. Okay. I think people are writing other problems now, I think. Okay, right. Yes, I agree with you. Right. Okay. So it's not lack of methodology. Maybe it's non-use of methodology. I agree with you. Thank you very much if that's what you intended. So this is about the problem. So I have not told you any problems, but you have told me the problems that you have. I just would like you to go back after this class over with a relief that, oh, these are not problems. These are different perspectives which perhaps I cannot cure. Let me not worry about them. There is something that I can do. Let me try doing that, right? That is what the message is. Okay. Be ready. Actually, I wanted a poll on this, but maybe because I'm not able to hold a poll now, you can quickly go to the chat box and write to me. I'm going to show you 3 items. You have to tell me, all of you have to vote, please. You have to tell me which is the most essential for teaching and also perhaps for learning a language as a second language. So these are the 3 things. One is instruction, one is environment, and one is motivation. You need not type the whole word. You can just say I for instruction, E for environment, M for motivation. Please begin typing your answers. Which do you think is the most important? Good. Sai Kiran Mai says motivation is important. Kalpana says motivation is important. Dr. Reddy Shekhar Reddy says instruction is important. Yes, and Srinivas Kumar says environment is important, and Virendra Reddy says environment is important, Suresh Kumar says environment is important, Sindhura M, motivation, LV Rao, E for environment, and I think Mohammed Gauss says why the students are unable to, etc. I cannot read that, that's scrolling, sorry. That's very fast. And Madhavi says E for environment, Sridevi says M for motivation. And Khadir Nista says E for environment. Balaji says M for motivation. Krishnamurti says M for motivation. Priyanka says M for motivation. Yes, Dr. Priyanka. Kamala says M for motivation. Beena says motivation. Venkateshwar Rao says instruction is very important. And Jyoti says motivation is important. Jyoti and David were the two people who answered the pre-assignment immediately, almost within a few minutes after it was launched yesterday night. Okay, I'll come to that a little later. Mani says motivation is important. Vijayalakshmi says motivation is important. Suresh Kumar says motivation is important, but environment also is important. Yes, thank you so much. But I don't know why many more people are not participating. Only some 30, 40 people have given the response. Anyway, thank you so much for your responses. I agree with you. All these three are important. We can learn a language if it is instructed by a good teacher. If I have a good teacher, the chances are brighter for me to learn a language. If I have the right environment, suppose I go and live in Chennai for 6 months, maybe I can learn Tamil easier if I have the right environment. If there are two people in my family who speak English well, perhaps my chances of learning English are better. Good, I agree with you. Motivation, unless I am motivated, I cannot learn, I cannot teach. So the teacher's responsibility is not only to teach, but also to motivate the students. Thank you for saying that. I think a majority, quite a lot of you have said motivation. I would like you to, because you gave this answer, I would like you to begin thinking that it's not teaching grammar, it's not teaching language, it's not teaching the poetry textbook, that's important, but more important is motivating your students. So maybe this will resolve other problems also, like absenteeism or whatever. So thank you very much for your participation, for your answers. I think some more answers are coming. I have closed the chat box, maybe I'll see it later. Right, so let me move on. But I would like to give my answer additionally, in addition to the three things that we have listed there. All three are important, I agree with you, but more important than these three things is the opportunity to use the target language is even more important. In fact, I know people who learn a language by using it even without the other three. I also know people, despite the best instruction, the right environment, and excellent motivation by the teachers, still do not learn a language because they do not get opportunity to use it. I think I must make a very important point here. So, as an English teacher, teaching English as a second language in India, in Telangana, where Telugu is the mother tongue of most people, Telugu or Urdu, are the, I mean, a large majority of people. So, speaking, teaching English is certainly difficult. So, the answer to all the problems that you suggested in the previous slides, and also the problems that we added there, have a solution evolving here. I think if you understand this one slide, perhaps you've understood this entire presentation. This 3-hour presentation will become very clear to you if you just understand this one slide. What I'm trying to tell you is, instruction is good, but not enough. Because all of you have told me that you tried teaching them, but the students are not learning. You admitted it in the previous slide and also when you chatted. So we are all good teachers. Some of us are excellent teachers. One of the participants today is adjudged the best state level teacher, right? And he's going to be awarded the Best Teacher Award soon. I saw his photograph just now. Right? Okay. So there are excellent teachers amongst us. There are very brilliant teachers, very highly committed teachers. Instruction is good. But still, why are not students learning English? So there must be some problems aware, no? Despite a good teacher teaching good content in a good environment, right? And with good motivation and all that, if students are not learning English, there must be some reason. What's that reason? The reason is item number 4. Do students have opportunity, or have I given opportunity to my students in my class to use English? Not to listen to English, to use. Listening is just one form of it. Have my students got enough opportunity to use English language the way it should be used in real life conditions? And if I have done that, my students will have automatically become proficient in the target language. Environment is not enough. I go to Tamil Nadu and spend there 6 months. I don't make any effort to learn Tamil. After 6 months, what happens? In Hyderabad, there are at least maybe lakhs of people, not crores, lakhs of people who have come from other states. They have lived here for decades. They have lived here for 2 decades, 3 decades, but still they don't speak Telugu. They say, hame Telugu nahi aata sa. We can't speak Telugu. Why? Because the environment is there, but they have not used it. Except a few words that they speak to their servants. At home, servants ko kaam batana padta na. Now only that much local language they learn. That too, maybe the women at home learn. In case they don't learn, I'm not talking about those who have learned. I'm talking about those who have not learned. There is a quite sizable section of them. Maybe there are very bright examples. People who have come here from somewhere and within no time they picked up the local language. That's the brighter side, the positive side. I'm talking about the negative side, those who have not learned. Why have they not learned? Because the environment is there. You said those who said environment is important, I'm telling you, environment is important, environment is available, but I don't use. Okay, the third one, motivation. We are all motivating our students. Some of us are doing an extraordinary job. Some English teachers are good soft skills teachers. Some English teachers are brilliant motivators. Some English teachers I know personally are very highly passionate. They do so much homework for themselves. They go to the class with great passion. They pump motivation into their students. They always are highly energetic, right? I mean, the way they present themselves to their students is, I mean, really remarkable. But still their students are not learning English. Why? Because it's not only the top 3 things that are enough, that play a big role, but that are not enough. More important than the top 3 things, the 4th one, opportunity to use English as a second language in your own situation, in your own classroom, is more important, or perhaps supremely important. More important than environment, more important than motivation, more important than instruction. Look at it from one more point of view. How many languages have we learned without any instruction? The man on the street who is learning English, any language as a first language, Telugu, for instance, the people on the street, maybe your grandparents, they did not go to any college or school. They learned Telugu without any instruction. How was that possible? Because they used it. They learned it as a first language, of course. But they used it. First language is acquired because people begin using it. Now, the question that I would like you to ask you to begin thinking on is, how can I make my students start using English for their needs so that they'll become conversant in the language that I'm trying to teach them? So my instruction, my efforts to create the right environment and my motivation will yield results only if I create an opportunity for my students to use English. Mr. Narayanamurthy, I think you have to mute one or two people who are speaking somewhere. You have to identify them, to go to the participants and identify which microphone is on, and please switch that off.
Thank you, sir. I'll do it, sir.
Yeah, please. Right. Coming back. So what is my job as a teacher? My job as a teacher is not only to instruct, not only to motivate, not only to environment, but also give plenty of opportunities to my students to use English language. If we do that, nobody can stop our students from becoming masters of English very soon. I think there are great successful teachers among you. I think those who are listening to me now, right in this group, there are quite a lot of successful teachers, right? And maybe let me move on from here. So I think you have understood this concept, this one idea that I wanted to drill into your minds and hearts has gone deep into your impression, and I'm sure if you begin thinking of this, I think results will begin coming. Now let's look at the possibilities. Okay, I understood the problem now, the real problem now. One second, I'll just go back to that slide and tell you one more thing. Suppose I go to the class, I have a 45 minute class today. My graduate students, maybe 50 students in my class, are sitting there. And I engage. I'm a good teacher. I'm a passionate teacher, right? I'm a learned scholar, and I go to the class, and my English is perfect. I go and speak in the class for 45 minutes, and I finish my lesson and come. Now, just you have to answer one simple question. Have you understood the concept, the situation? The situation is, I am a good teacher. I'm a dedicated, conscientious teacher. My English is extremely good. I'm very passionate, right? I do whatever I do with wholeheartedly. I go to the class and I take my class, 45 minutes, I speak, and I come out of the car, my class is over. Whose English improves? The question. Whose English improves? Just type your answer in the chat box. Nobody is answering. Yes, thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. I'll not disclose the answer yet, but you are giving very good answers. Wonderful. Thank you so much. Good, 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 good. Right. So that's the trick. So if I go to the class and speak good English, it's my English that's improving. Every day I am becoming a better user of English. I spoke for 40 minutes today. My English has improved. Tomorrow I speak for 40 minutes, my English has improved. The whole year I've spoken English, I've used English, I've written English, and my English has improved. But what has happened to my students? They have not opened their mouths in my class. They have not written anything except when I dictate. Writing is not dictating, I'll come to that. Right, okay. So what has happened? Their English skills have not improved. My English skills have enormously improved. That's why we see many, many English teachers, when they join as a teacher, their English may not be good, but within 3-4 years, they become excellent, proficient users of English. So again, that brings us to the same point. That's because the teacher has opportunity to use English. His English is improving. The student does not have opportunities to use English. And that's why his English is not improving. Tomorrow he goes out to the college and then goes for an interview. He cannot say one sentence in English, and that's where we have failed. He has failed and we have failed. Right. So let's move on. So the possibilities. So what are some possibilities? What are some solutions that we can apply to make our teaching better? Right. Okay, I'm not going to give you hundreds of solutions. Just to only two solutions which will change the entire perspective. If you want to become the best teacher in the world, if you want to have great results from your class, if you want your students to really pick up the skills of English, and if you want your students to become proficient users of English, what do you need to do? Just two things. Interesting? Do you like to know those two tricks, those two tips, those two magic wands? That can make us great teachers. Teaching English as a second language will become extremely easy and productive and rewarding, right? The outcomes will be enormously different if we do these two things. What are the two things? Let me not hold you in suspense for a very long time. The two things are, we should become facilitators instead of continuing as teachers. Every English teacher must evolve into a facilitator. Trick one, that's all. Just do this, half your job is done. So stop teaching, start facilitating. Stop teaching. That sounds shocking, no? Sir, if I don't teach, my principal won't keep quiet, sir. If I don't teach, the commissioner will not keep quiet, sir. If I don't teach, I won't be doing my job, sir. No problems at all. I am assuring you, you will be not blamed, but you'll be rewarded. You'll be recognized as the best, right? David, are you still there? Will you please switch on your microphone for a moment? I don't know if you're there. David, I can't see you. One second. Yeah, David Raju is here. I am unmuting you, David.
Okay, sir.
David, are you a teacher or a facilitator in your class?
I'm a facilitator, sir.
What is the difference between the two?
I create a positive environment for students to learn. Instead of showing my teaching ability, I make it a student-centered class.
Great. Also, because you asked me to keep it quite confidential, but I cannot resist the temptation to tell everybody that you're going to be awarded the best teacher award, right? Hearty congratulations. Right.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Right. So the first thing that we need to do is we must become facilitators. Teachers, language teachers, I mean, language teachers must become facilitators. Who is this? Hello, who is this speaking? Narayan Murthy, you have to help me.
Sir, that was some Vidyavati. You can mute her. This sir, is some Vidyavati.
I made you host, sir. Only you can mute, sir.
You should make me a co-host so that to be easy. Otherwise, doing both the things will be very difficult. I can't locate her here.
Yeah, request all the participants.
Vidyavati, where is she?
Yeah, being the host, you have the option to mute all, sir.
I have the option, but every time I have to stop, you know, I know I have the option. I have muted her.
You can mute all and you can unmute yourself.
That does not leave it completely unmuted. Some people can still unmute themselves. Anyway, the problem of being the host is that you have an where my students down on their own and remain there, and then maybe something that they are learning, trying to learn on their own, right? That's not enough. So my methodology must change. It's not just introducing a laboratory. What will laboratory do? The laboratory is like a substitute to a teacher. Yes, please. So these are the two tricks that you need to pick up as English teachers to make your teaching more productive and to reward your students with real learning happening. The teacher should become a facilitator. The methodology must be CLT. I think you know what said CLT? C stands for communicative. T anyway, you know, T stands for teaching. And what's L? L stands for language. Communicative language teaching, which is useful not only to teach English, but any language. Telugu, Hindi, Sanskrit, whatever languages are taught in your college. So I mean, it indirectly applies to even other subject teachers also, most parts of it. So to summarize, two tricks that every ESL teacher, every English teacher should quickly equip oneself with is evolving into the role of a facilitator instead of continuing as a teacher, and changing my methodology instead of lecturing, trying to use communicative language teaching techniques. Let me go into a few details. The first one, what is this facilitator? David told us something, he created environment or whatever, but what exactly it is? So I created a very simple word of four letters to help you remember what this facilitator is. If you remember the letters F-A-C-E, you remember what facilitator does. So these four letters stand for these four things. What does a facilitator do? The facilitator fosters student-centric climate in the class. Once again, I have to go back here and then I have to see who are these people who are using the microphone. Right, I think. Oh, this really, I know this happens if you're in a physical class, don't worry. Even if you're giving a lecture in a physical class, the next room sometimes disturbs you, that happens. Okay, so fostering student-centric climate is the first quality of a good facilitator. What is this fostering student-centric climate? Some teachers say, sir, anyway, my class is student-centered, sir. All the time I'm teaching students only, that's why I'm there. The student is the center. I stand in a corner there. The students are in the center of the classroom. And they are the focus. I'm teaching them. Everything that I do in the class, it is for them. I teach for them. I hold an examination for them. I do everything for them only. It's already student-centered. No. That is not student-centered. Student-centered is looking at everything starting from the curriculum design, starting from the definition of the objectives of the teaching learning process, to evaluating, to assessing, and to using the outcomes, etc., etc. Everything must be focused around the students. To help you understand easier, maybe I'll just give an example. Maybe I'll also open the chat box for you. Maybe you can give an answer to that. I'll give some two or three statements. You have to tell me which is student-centered. I'll see statement one. I will teach my students the present simple tense tomorrow. Sentence one. Statement two. The simple present tense will be taught tomorrow. The third sentence, my students will have learned the simple present tense by tomorrow afternoon. So out of these three, which is student-centric? Wonderful. Excellent. So Priya Srivatsava, then Sai Kiranmayi, Sindhura, Penugonda, Shanti Prabha, and many, many, many others have given the correct answer. The correct answer is the third sentence, which is the only student-centric in that, because we are defining an objective from the student's point of view. When you go to class tomorrow, go with a clear focus, not on what you are going to do, but what students will have learned by the time you finished your lesson. Every day before you go to the class, make it a point. Reflect for 2 minutes. What will my students have learned by the time my class is over? Right? This one question you must have an answer. See, people talk about lesson plan and all that. Maybe, I don't know how many of you believe in writing down the lesson plan, how many of you have arguments on that. But the lesson plan, whether you write it or create it here, has a purpose. The purpose is, what will be the outcome? If you can write that outcome, the rest of it is not perhaps as important. We must know, suppose I have come to this class today, I must come with a very clear vision of what I want to teach you today, or what you will have learned by the end of this presentation today. So starting from there, right up to the outcomes, definition of outcomes, definition of the assessment process, and the teaching methodology, the sourcing of the textbooks, etc., etc. Everything must be centered around the student. That is fostering student-centered climate. Again, please don't go back to those complaints and say, sir, the textbook is designed by somebody. What can I do, sir? How can I make it student-centric? Don't worry about things that you cannot do. We are not going to worry about things that we cannot change. I cannot change the world. I cannot conquer corona, but I can protect myself. But if I don't go out, and then if I take a little precaution, maybe I'm trying to limit the risk that I expose myself to. I may not be able to discover a medicine for that. Somebody else is doing that, okay, right? I cannot create a vaccine for that. Somebody is already working on that. My job is to save myself, at least. So as an English teacher, working in a small place like Sitanagaram, and I am maybe, sir, this is a very small college in a big world, and I am handling just 50 students out of the several millions of students that are in graduate classes all around in my own university. There are lakhs of them. Sir, what can I do? Don't worry about that. You are working in your small world, trying to bring about a small change. Whatever you can change, please change that so that your students are better equipped with the necessary skills, right? That's it. Okay, the second one. Augment, A stands for augment, interactive environment. What is this interactive environment? For at least 3 or 4 times today so far, I have asked you to type in the chat box. In fact, if you use your microphones carefully, I would like you to intervene and unmute yourself and speak also. That's what I told you in the beginning. Why that's necessary? I think we have already been here for almost an hour and longer than that. And the 60, 70 minutes that we have spent together, suppose I have only lectured, right? Only just lecture, even without this slideshow, without going back to those examples that I showed you, without asking you any questions, without asking you to chat, whatever, this lesson would not have been this effective. Even now it's not, I don't think it's greatly effective because of so many other barriers that we have, especially because it's virtual, it's not a regular physical classroom. But despite that, what is it that you can do in your situation to involve your students by creating an interactive environment? So students talk to you, you talk to students talk to each other, some interaction happening so that the purpose is to create an opportunity for students to use language, U-S-E, use, that must, I mean, get deeply ingrained in your mind. Everything that you do must be focused at that. Use, equip your students and create opportunities for them to use language. Right. The third one, cultivate their communication skills. So many times students have questions, but they cannot ask questions. Why does that happen? It happens because they don't know how to ask a question. They don't have the language to ask a question. Madam, I have a question. They cannot say even this. Madam, will you please say that again? Suppose some student has not understood it, right? I mean, he actually would like you to repeat that, but he does not know how to say that. And you gave me that one of the problems is the diffidence. The students have some issues. They don't like to, I mean, even ask that question because of various reasons. Shyness, diffidence, etc., etc. So you have to create an environment, plus you have to give them the necessary language. Right? How do you say at least some basic things? Madam, is this possible? How do we spell that word, madam? So the student must first know that is called classroom language. The classroom language, at least if the student knows, and if you encourage them to participate in the class, perhaps they will begin opening their mouths to use language and use other forms of language use. I'll come to this third point a little later again in detail. The fourth one, E, extremely important, right? I think many teachers think that because they have finished their post-graduation or an MPhil or a PhD and have already got a job, importantly a government job, so their learning is over. I know everything, right? I've got a gold medal, right? I'm a learned scholar. What else is there for me to learn? I only teach now. I think every teacher, at least today is Teacher's Day, and we should all resolve to call ourselves learners rather than teachers. Or maybe teacher learners, learner teachers, facilitators. We'll call ourselves by some other names, not just teachers. Okay, it may not be out of place to wish you all a very happy Teacher's Day at this point. So happy Teacher's Day plus this. So we must be continuous learners. What do we learn further? I have to decide, do I have to read Shakespeare again or a short story again? Or maybe do I have to improve my grammar skills? Or do I have to improve my writing skills? So I am the best judge of myself. What do I need? What does my class need? What skills I am deficient in? What skills do I need to equip myself with further, etc., etc.? These questions, I'll give you some questions also towards the end. So these questions I need to ask myself and continuously enrich, equip myself with my skills so that I enrich myself. A continuous journey. And learning is a continuous journey for anybody, especially for a teacher. A teacher who stops learning is a dead teacher, as good as a dead teacher. The day we stop learning, I think our journey had stopped. Just maybe it may not be out of place to tell you that I am 67 years old now. I worked for government of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana those days before bifurcation, and I retired from government service long ago, maybe about 8-9 years ago. And I continue to teach because it's my passion and continue. What did I know about blended learning? 2 months ago, I did not know about it. I did not even know what blended learning was, but I learned it. I gave some lectures on blended learning recently. So we must be continuously learning, equipping ourselves with new skills, right? So that's what it is. Let's move from here. The first one, sorry, I think, yeah, facilitator, right? So communicative, I said, the teacher must become, this is, I told you there are two principles. One, the teacher must become a facilitator, and two, the teacher must use the communicative language teaching technique. Right, the first one I told you, so this is what makes a teacher a facilitator. If you try these four things in your class, automatically you become a facilitator, you are no longer a teacher. So what does a facilitator does? A facilitator fosters student-centered climate and augments interactive environment, cultivates the communication skills of the students, and improves himself or herself. Right? If you do these four things, you are a facilitator. If you are already doing it, you are on the journey, and then you have an opportunity to continuously upgrade yourself further. Give me 1 second again. I am muting this person. Pala Sri Rangaya. I don't know who this is. I think I'm not able to mute some people. There is, I don't know what's, yeah, right. Okay, so this is point one. So there are 2 points. The first one is becoming facilitator. This is how we become facilitators. The second point, let's move on to the second. The second point is using the communicative language teaching methodology in the class. This is a photograph of one of my corporate classes. I was invited to Birla Aditya Group to talk to some executives, and because the photograph quality was good, I chose this. Otherwise, any photograph is okay. So your classes, typically, I mean, I've been asked by government of Telangana and government of Andhra Pradesh on many, many, many occasions to visit colleges, to observe teachers, to hold classes, to take training programs, etc., etc. Observation is not something that I really enjoy doing, but maybe because the government needs it. So sometimes we would have been given those assignments and we had to go. So a classroom typically looks different, not like this. Students are made to sit down in fixed places. They are not allowed to open their mouths. I had a teacher when I was young, one of my teachers used to say, "Bloody fellows, if anybody opens your mouth, I'll cut your tongue." This was a very popular abuse that he had ready. So every day he used to tell us at least 10 times, "I'll cut your tongue." So students were never allowed to open their mouths. They were not allowed to speak. I think in some colleges, the situation is still the same. Very unfortunate. So in case the teacher continues to be a teacher or just remains an instructor or a tutor, maybe that's not enough. The teacher must gradually become this, a facilitator. So a facilitator positions himself differently, allows lots of activity in the class, encourages the right kind of environment, right? And makes the whole thing student-centric, right? See here, that's how the students are involved in the class. They are speaking to each other and then they are doing an activity. The whole idea is to teach English again, learning English, the activity-based way. And the teacher, of course, is standing here. What's the teacher doing? The teacher is, of course, not silently listening things, but he's actively engaged in watching things and at the same time monitoring the class. So the teacher is not passive, he is active, but not noisy, not all the time speaking. I think there is a lot of difference between the two. So the teacher becomes a facilitator. Things happen in the class because the teacher has ensured that things happen. Okay. So, what is this? I think you can understand this picture without much explanation. So, there is a picture here. There is a green bottle. I think you can see the word written here is knowledge. Anybody would like to unmute yourself and then say something about this picture that you see there? If you raise your hand, I think one Vivek has raised the hand. I am Mr. Vivek. I'm unmuting you. Would you like to speak? Mr. Vivek, are you there? You raised your hand. I don't know why. Okay, maybe you just raised without knowing what you're doing. Perhaps anybody would like to speak anything about the picture that you saw on the screen? I'll unmute you. You can raise your hand. I'll unmute you and you can speak. I don't see any hands risen. Very bad. I don't know if you are in the class or you have switched on your...
No, sir.
somebody, Dr. Sai Kiranmayi. Sai Kiranmayi, I am unmuting you. Would you like to say something about the picture that you see?
Yes, sir.
Yeah,
good morning, please. Everyone.
Good morning.
Wish you all happy Teacher's Day, sir.
Thank you.
I learned from the photograph. I see that a teacher should be a perennial learner. And if we become knowledgeable, we can share that to the students. So our teacher should be a voracious reader and should keep abreast of the latest technologies as well as the knowledge.
Wonderful.
To share that with the students.
Right. Thank you, Sai Kiranmayi. Sai Kiranmayi, we saw that in the previous slide, but maybe I think that the previous slide is still, you are thinking of that anyway. Okay. Anybody else would like to speak? One more person?
Sir, LVR.
Yeah, LV Rao, please. Yes.
Teachers Day, sir.
Thank you.
Knowledge is the oxygen to the mind. Knowledge is the oxygen.
Right. Thank you so
much. May I have a word, sir?
Please go ahead.
Something represents some negative connotation. Something is being forcibly induced to students' mind.
Okay.
I don't know how I get that answer.
Thank you. I appreciate both the sides. Both of you, Sai Kiranmayi and Rao, said that, of course, the teachers must continuously update themselves. That's wonderful. I agree. David also said that this is a negative connotation because something is being poured there. Both are right. What I would like to tell you is typically, maybe in about 70-80% of the classes that I have seen during my observations, that I've seen, not in the past, not 10 years ago, not 5 years ago, recently, last year, so when I went around on some government assignment and went to schools and colleges and sat down in the schools and colleges in English classes and observed teachers. So in many cases, maybe 70% might be an exaggeration, but maybe at least 50-60% of the teachers believed in this concept of transferring knowledge to the students. What were they doing? Like David said, so the teacher comes to the class and then brings some knowledge with him or her, and then she transfers her knowledge to the students. Good. One way it's good. But if it is a physics class, if it's a maths class, if it's a biology class, perhaps, even there, not compulsory, perhaps it's okay. It's okay. I'm not saying it's good. It's okay. Maybe we can accept that. Because who is really interested in coming to college for the sake of gaining knowledge? Knowledge is today available everywhere. Knowledge that's more accurate, more attractively packaged, right? Easier to grasp, and more picturesque, more impressive, is available everywhere, just at the click of a button. You go to Google and search, I think all that the teacher can say is already available. I go to YouTube, the best teachers in the world have already created lessons on any topic that you want to teach, and they are there. So if you think that the student comes to the class for the sake of knowledge, we are very seriously mistaken. Right? That's about the subject classes. But about the language class, coming to English language class. So what is happening here? Suppose this is the teacher. The teacher has knowledge. Of course, the teacher has knowledge. And this is the student. And you are transferring that knowledge to the student. So what's happening? The teacher is addressing. SST stands for teacher. SS stands for student. So teacher is transferring knowledge to students. This is the most ineffective way of teaching a language. Let me repeat that sentence, underline that word ineffective. This is the most ineffective, non-productive, unrewarding, useless way of teaching a language. In other subjects, maybe 20%, 30%, 40%, 50%, it's okay. But in language classes, it's zero use. Why? Again, go back to that slide. Opportunity to use is completely missing. The student is only given knowledge, which is available elsewhere. Also, the student most likely has not come here for that. He has come here to improve his language skills and have not given him that, and that's why the class has fallen flat. One second, please. Gentlemen, I don't know who is this Uppala Sri Ranganath. Please, please don't distract the class. I had to mute you some 4 or 5 times so far. Whoever you are, so please don't again unmute yourself and disturb the class. You must be a teacher. Right, okay. So what else can be done? If I don't teach my students, if I don't transfer my knowledge to my students, what else should I do? There are lots of things that can happen in the English language class. What are the things? At the most basic level, instead of speaking to all the students, the teacher can speak to one student at a time, not all the class, but sometimes. Sometimes encourage your student to speak to you. So the student speak, write, listen, whatever. So the one student interacting with one teacher. Sometimes all students interacting with the teacher. And in a great class, David told us what a facilitator is. And in a great class, not only the students speaking to teachers and teachers speaking to students, but encourage students speaking to students. When does this happen? When you allow one student to speak to another student. Things like pair work, group work, etc. And sometimes you can have all students speaking to all students. How is that possible? Perhaps a group discussion, a debate, etc. Quite a lot of students are engaged in the process of learning together. Lots of group works are happening in the class, right? Many groups are created and everybody is using English productively for a real purpose. We have created an information gap, for instance, right? And then students are actively engaged in meeting that gap so that in the process, they learn English. Whatever happens in the English class, remember, that one golden principle, whatever happens in the English class does not happen for itself. It should happen to promote the learning of English language. If I take a football to the class, and if I ask my students to play football in my class, right, the objective is not to teach the art of the skill of playing football to my students, but I have an ulterior objective of improving their English language skills. So everything that happens in an English class must have the goal of helping my students equip themselves with language skills. So in case there are any teachers attending this class today who confine themselves to this technique one, methodology one, teacher goes to the class and addresses the students. This is called the lecture method. One is lecture. Lecture method is good in some situations. Maybe in a situation like this, for instance, this is a virtual class, very little interactivity is possible. But of course, despite that, we are trying here and there. So this is the first one. Is not very effective. And again, today I'm not teaching you the skills because you are already English lecturers, but I'm teaching you how to teach. So it can be a lecture also. But the other 5 things, talking to individual students, allowing your individual students to seek clarifications, ask questions, seek clarifications on their doubts, all students addressing you, one student speaking to another student, many, many students engaged together in the process of learning. If all 6 kinds of things are happening in your class, maybe if not every day, at least as frequently as possible, then I think you have become a facilitator and your class has become communicative. Without this, if it's only the first one, there's no communication happening. Even if you think that you have communicated something, there's no guarantee that it has gone to the right, it has gone in the right direction or it has helped the people. So please take a minute to ask yourself, reflect, what am I doing in my class? Yesterday in my class, how long did I speak? Did my students get any opportunity to use English in any in any form, any skill? So were they able to equip themselves with any of those skills, and are they better, more proficient because of what they learned yesterday? Did I speak the whole time, or did I allow my students to speak to me? Did I write everything on my own, or did my students have an opportunity to write something productively? Writing is not handwriting. Handwriting is handwriting, not writing. Handwriting is different, writing is different. Right? So have I helped them with their listening skills? So what did my students get from my class yesterday? If I begin analyzing every one of my classes like that, perhaps very soon I'll be a great teacher. Right. These four things that you see on the screen are believed to be, are predominantly declared to be language skills. Strictly speaking, they are not language skills, but okay, they are communication skills, but LSRW, I mean, English teachers generally take them for granted. When I ask them, so what are the language skills? They say LSRW. Listening, speaking, reading, writing, receptive skills, productive skills, etc. In case somebody is good with these four things, still there is no guarantee that one will be a proficient user of the target language, in our case, English language. Suppose one can listen really well, one can read well, one can write well, one can speak well, still, despite all that, there is something lacking. What's that? There are some other skills which are more properly called language skills, and there are, some people call them sub-skills. I mean, the names, don't worry about the names. I don't want to disturb that hornet's nest and then unnecessarily get into trouble also. So those four skills, we'll still take them as language skills and communication skills, but grammar skills, vocabulary skills, pronunciation skills, collocations, forgotten. Many teachers themselves do not, unfortunately. At maybe lower levels. So usage, some students know words, but they don't know how to use them. They use the words in the wrong context, for the wrong purpose, in the wrong way. Lots of other things. Then nonverbal communication, which may not be strictly speaking a language skill, but it's a communication skill. But all these things together are should be our focus. These are, whether language skills or whatever skills you call them, these skills are for the purpose of improving the communication skills of my student. If my student is good with one but not good with others, no use. Right? So my students must be good with all of them together. It's a comprehensive enabling. So my student must be good with all these things. Good vocabulary, enough vocabulary, good grammar, right grammar, accurate grammar, intelligible pronunciation, the knowledge of the right word combinations. And all these things are essential. Okay, let's just take one or two examples in the remaining time. And I think we have quite a lot of time. Okay, we are going to do one exercise. This exercise, perhaps some of you have done the ELT workshops and other workshops in the past, perhaps know it. I have chosen the same because it's it lends itself to the activity. It's very good, actually. All of you, in case you have a paper with you, a pen with you, scribbling pad with you, it's good. Otherwise, also, you can just go close attention and listen to me and do this exercise. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to play a very short audio, very short, 2 minutes. And then what you need to do is, you have to listen to something and answer these four questions. What are the four questions? How many men were there? How many of them were thin, not fat? How many had dark hair? How many had big ears? The questions seem to be very simple, and these four questions need answers. And if you carefully see, all four begin with how many. That means the answers are a number. How many? Always the answer is a number. So all that you need to do is you have to write a number as an answer. Okay. Maybe in case you want to some help, you can draw some stick figures like this as you are listening. So you see a small stick figure. I think anybody can draw a line or whatever. And then this will help you listen more carefully and attentively. So if you are ready, I'll start. So what do you have to do? Maybe what I'll do is I'll pick up somebody random. Amala Stella, is she there? Amala Stella, are you there? Stella, I'm unmuting you. You're not there, I think. Anita G, are you there? Oh, where are you? I think you have joined the program and you're not there. Anita, no, she's not there. Maybe B. Ashok is there. B. Ashok. B. Ashok also is not here. Very surprising. Arji Mahalakshmi. Mahalakshmi, are you there? You can raise your hand or you can unmute yourself. I think Ramalakshmi is here.
Sir, yes, sir.
Ramalakshmi, yes. Please yes, keep yourself unmuted. I have a small question for you.
Yes, sir. Good morning.
Yeah, good morning, Ramalakshmi. What do you do? Have you heard me?
Yes, sir.
I gave you an assignment. What's the assignment? Will you please repeat?
Yeah, we have to listen to the audio.
Right.
And we have to answer this question, sir, which is a number.
That's all. Thank you so much, Ramalakshmi. Thank you. Why I did this is in a real class also, we can do things like this so that the students are engaged in the class. Right? So they are participating in the class. So now I know who are there and some of them are not there perhaps. Or maybe they could not unmute themselves. It's okay. Right. 1 second. Let me just mute these people. Yes, please. I think somebody is still speaking. Right. Okay. So the audio will begin now. Please be careful. So I told you, in case you want, you can draw some stick figures so that it will be easy for you to remember. If you are ready, I'm playing it.
We can manage to be. But the deepest sign of dealing with people is to think of with them.
It's not audible, sir.
1 second. I think the audio settings are perhaps not right. I'm changing them. I'll play it again for you. I think you can hear now. Now this time you can hear, I think.
There were five men. The first was tall and thin. He had a square face with blue eyes and curly fair hair. The second was short and fat with a roundish face and short straight dark hair. The third was of medium build. I didn't see his face, but he had longish dark hair. The fourth man was quite thin, medium height. He had a long thin face with a big nose. His hair was dark and curly and had a mustache and a beard. The last man was short and plumpish with very short blonde hair. I didn't see his face. But I remember his ears. They were very big.
Okay, I think you have heard that. Sorry that audio did not play well in the beginning. Would anybody like to answer that questions? Maybe even if you cannot answer them, it's okay. You can just write the numbers in the chat box. The first question at least. The first question, how many people were there? Chat box, oh good, 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 very good. Talapaka, Sindhura and Raghuram and Government Degree College and Penagunda Sahiti, Suresh Kumar, etc. have all given the correct number. Five is the answer to the first question. Last one, how many had big ears? How many of them had big ears? Sai, Kiran Mai and Raghuram and Ramakrishnan Murthy, Krishnamurthy, Muhammad, Sindhura, so many, Vivek, Chandrasekhar, Kamala, and Kalpana, Deshmukh. So, except Priyanka, many of you have said one. Let's see. Okay, so the numbers are not important to me now. I'm not interested in the right or wrong answers. Let me just look at it as an English teacher. I'm not a maths teacher. So, you are numeric abilities are relevant to me. So whether you said 1 or 10, that's not important. Of course, the real answer, the correct answers are here. I'll show you. The correct answers are 5, 2, 3, 1. Maybe if you want, I can play it again also later. But I'm looking at something else. As a language teacher, I would like any one of you to, I wish you had the opportunity to unmute yourself. Or maybe you can raise your hand better. I'll ask you, you have to tell me what was the learning process involved in this. What did I do to ensure that you are listening to me? Sai Kiran Mai, you spoke once. I think you'd like to speak again, Sai Kiran Mai.
Yes, sir. If you,
please,
give me an opportunity.
Please go ahead.
Thank you very much, sir. The listening capacity of the audience is, I think, is being tested here.
Right, but what did I do to ensure that you are listening to it?
You made it a comprehension, a listening comprehension, to make sure that we have grasped everything from the audio. We have listened properly.
How did I do that? What was the technique I used?
Questioning, sir. Questioning was
okay,
the method.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. That's the correct answer. But still, one more person can also answer this question. Anybody? I think Vivek has raised his hand. I think I am unmuting you. Vivek, would you like to add anything to that? Vivek, you raised your hand. No. I think... Venkateshwara Dhatrika, do you like to say something? Dhatrika Venkateshwara Rao.
Okay, next one, Jita, next one.
Vidyavati? Vidyavati, is she there? Vidyavati, are you there? I think you are unmuted.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, before playing the video itself, you have prepared us to answer the questions.
How did I do that?
Just before you played the video, you have instructed us to do so, no?
Yes. Okay, thank you very much. Both of you gave very good answers. I think the logic behind the whole thing, it's a very short video, that's my own voice, I pre-recorded that. What I did is to ensure that at least most of you listen to me, instead of just directly playing an audio to you, I gave you some questions. I repeated the questions. I told you what kind of answers to expert. I told you how everyone begins with how many. So it's a number that you have to give as an answer, etc. I asked you to keep a pen and paper ready so that you may do something on that to remember better. I asked you to draw some pictures if necessary. right? I did all these things to ensure that you are listening to me carefully. Listening is a language skill, a communication skill. It does not just happen like that. Suppose many teachers, what do they do? They just go to the class, play a video or play an audio. Students, hello, have you listened to that? What did he say? They were not paying attention. Suppose you give the questions before and you ask them, oh, these are the questions that I have for you. When you are listening to that conversation, you have to find answers to these questions. Automatically, their focus, their attention automatically increases. Tomorrow, you have a class and you go with this objective. Tomorrow, I want to improve the listening skills of my students. The whole idea of whatever I'm going to do in the class tomorrow is to improve the English listening skills of my students. Can they do these kinds of sentences and make out what I mean, what the paragraph means, what the passage means, what the audio means, etc. Right? Then you go with a plan. As soon as you go to the class, you give them a question, a task. Oh, basically, okay, I'll give you some, I'm going to play an audio which has some instructions. You have to enact those instructions. And the audio will say, okay, raise your right hand. Do something like that. So maybe they have to listen. So they must be able to follow the pronunciation. They must be able to follow the words, vocabulary used. They must be able to grasp that and they must be able to execute that. So generally, teachers, either because they don't know or because they do not have time or because they do not have the inclination, they just think that their students have listened to them. Please don't do that. Listening is a skill that needs enormous use. Again, going back to that four things that I focused on. Environment is not enough. Instruction is not enough. Right? Motivation. Has he used his listening skills? Has he applied skills every day? To begin teaching, I think the first thing that when you enter the class, if you are an English teacher, the first thing that you should go to the class, after you go to the class, is maybe write four questions on the board or dictate them, no problem, and tell them, I am going to answer these four questions today in my class. And at the end of the class, I am going to ask you the same four questions. You have to answer. Your class will transform into extremely highly communicative class. If you're doing it, it's great. If you're not doing it, begin doing it. Today, for instance, one of my first slides, the second slide that I showed you today, I said, okay, these are the four things I want to achieve today. These are the four objectives that I have in my class. These are the components that I am going to deal with. Why do I do that? Because you will know and you will look forward to them. In which component are we to now? We are in the third component. In case we get time, we'll do the fourth one also. Right. Okay. So this is the text that I played to you. And maybe in case you can do it in many different levels and many different ways. I just show you one way. Teaching grammar the same way, communicating way. What is the difference? The teaching grammar, if you want to, suppose, maybe before I show that, what like, suppose I go to a class today, I want to teach them some grammar point. It can be maybe use of adjectives, use of capital letters, punctuation, or maybe I want to teach them some tense, the simple present tense, simple continuous, present continuous tense, whatever. So I have an idea what I want to teach. Suppose I go to the class. I want to use a game or an entertainer or a joke or whatever tool I have, whatever material I have, I use it. So I go to a class and then I start my class like that. I say, okay, students, I'm going to talk to you about two deaf fellows today. There were two deaf fellows, two deaf boys, right? Do you know what is deaf? Deaf is somebody who cannot listen, somebody who cannot hear. Right, their ears don't work. Things are not audible to them. Okay, there are two deaf boys talking to each other. The first one asks the second one, is it an English class? And the second one said, no, it's an English class. And the first one said, oh, I thought it was an English class. Okay, I have finished telling them that joke. Why have I told them a joke? Maybe I have planned to build a grammar lesson or some other lesson, reading lesson, writing lesson, whatever, based on that. Not teachers going to the class and just telling jokes is useless. I mean, they become comedians if they do that. If you tell two jokes every day, and if you think that your classes are just humorous, no, students don't think like that. Teachers call you buffoons, comedians. So in case you tell a joke, that must be thoroughly connected with what you are going to teach. Suppose I have narrated that joke to my class, then what will I do? So I'll show something like this to my class. Two, three things I can do. Maybe I can immediately ask, suppose the students are a bright lot and they can immediately do something like this, an exercise like this. Oh, student, there are 32 mistakes in this, please correct them. Like that, I can give. Or maybe without even showing them this text, okay, I told you a joke, no? I want two students come here and then enact that play, do a role play. Now, the first role play has been done, only two students participated. Now, every one of you join with somebody, become pairs in the class, two of you, right? Everyone face each other and do that same role play. Maybe if necessary, if my students are not great users of English to begin with, maybe I write the dialogue on the board and then they need to just either copy it down in their notebooks and then try it, and then, or maybe if they are good, they can say the sentences in their own way. Okay? So what am I doing? I am using some kind of an authentic material to bring a lesson into the class. Suppose my students are not really great, I can give them clues like this. Okay, the red marked text had some mistakes, so it needs correction, and you need to correct that and put them right. Those words are wrong, or maybe something else is grammatically wrong there. And I can do lots of other things also. I can show them the text. I mean, what has happened? A dry grammar lesson becomes quite lively, interesting. The students will wait for the next item. And the students are using language in the class, using, not just listening and sitting, maybe sitting, not even listening, maybe they are just paying, giving you their ears to you, that's all, just hearing, that's all. So you have to bring life into the class and you have to bring communication into the class. So when this happens, all the students are engaged. Every student is making corrections. Every student is doing a role play. Every student is talking to somebody else. Everybody is seeking a clarification, some such thing, right? So anything that you do should have a communicative purpose. These are the seven questions that you can ask yourself. This you are not going to do now, but maybe this can be, you can take a screenshot here. And after going home, perhaps you can rate yourself. This is a self-assessment. So how good is my speaking skills? How good is my grammar? Do I know what collocations are? And do I use the right collocations? Do I know the difference between do and make, for instance? Is my pronunciation accurate? Is my vocabulary good? How fluently when I speak? Do I use a variety of structures, etc., etc.? These seven questions will help you make some kind of a very basic kind of an assessment. Be very objective. Don't overrate yourself and don't underrate yourself. I'll give you a trick here. Every teacher, every English teacher, the easiest way to improve yourself, I said the four things that a facilitator does, the last one, they remember, F-A-C-E, E stands for enhance your skills, enhance yourself, improve your own skills. So the easiest way to do that, I do it, that's why I'm telling you. The easiest way to do is you take your phone, keep it in the silent mode to the class, and then switch on the voice recorder If it does not function in the silent mode, maybe you can switch it on and ensure that calls are not happening. You can have it in the airplane mode. I mean, you must learn a few small things. And then you can have the voice recorder, right? You don't need a video recorder on that. Very simple, I'm telling you. You can have the voice recorder on. You can keep it in your own pocket or maybe keep it on the table. And then just do your class, your regular class. So 40 minutes, 45 minutes, your class is over. At the end of it, switch it off and then take it home. Spend, if a 40-minute class has been taken, spend 2 hours on that one class that you've given to carefully listen to everything that you uttered in the class. There are some softwares that can convert audio to text. If necessary, do that. Or maybe you can play it back at a slower pace and you can write it down. And listen to every sentence that you've made and ask yourself, can this sentence be better? Could I have used this word instead of this word? Should I have paused here? So did I ensure that my comma could be heard? Right? And was my voice audible? Did I swallow any words? Did I use any prop word too very frequently? How was my pronunciation? Did I pronounce this word right? How much time did I allow my students to respond to me, et cetera, et cetera. I think some students have raised that. Let me just check who this is, and then in case necessary, I'll give you an opportunity to speak. I think Vivek again. Kiran Mai also has raised her hand. Kiran Mai, do you have something to say?
No, sir, no.
Maybe you raised your hand, I don't know why.
Yes,
okay. Sir. Right. Okay, you just take that audio back home and then you play it to yourself and then you check where you have scope to improve yourself and that will be a great opportunity for you to improve your own skills. Nothing better than self-assessment, nothing better than our own effort to make ourselves better. As English teachers, we need to go through this process. For instance, this is getting recorded. So if I listen back to it, naturally, I know where you might, some of you, your presentations earlier also, you might have already seen that I don't use the same slideshow a second time. So at least 20%, 30%, 50% sometimes change happens between the same topic. Why do I do that? I do it for myself, not for others. In case I use the same slideshow, you will not even know that I am talking about the same thing, at the same way. I cannot change the content much, but I can change the content a little, but the presentation a lot. Right. Okay. So this is about body language. Again, I don't want to go into that. This is not my topic today. That's why I just wanted to make a passing remark about that. Your teachers must be very, very careful with their body language also. They must be conscious of what their body is speaking, what their eyes are doing, what their hands are doing, what their whole body is speaking. So your entire body speaks in your class, and teachers must be absolutely comfortable, right, being expressive with their body, right? These are some problems possible with your body language. Again, you can do some kind of self-assessment. Again, in case you do a video recording of your lesson instead of an audio recording, again, after going back home, you can watch yourself and you can ask questions. Have I made the right kind of eye contact? I know where I'm looking at. Am I looking at one student or only in one direction or only one small group of students? Or am I looking at the whole class? Do I know what's global contact? How am I using my hands? All this you can analyze for yourself. And if you're interested, you can even send that and share it with anyone, mentor that you may have, anyone who can help you with that, somebody, either your friend or colleague or your own family members, your children are your best critics, right? Okay, so you can share it with them and tell them, so where do I have scope for improvement, right? This I leave. I'll quickly come to the last part of my presentation because I think it's 12:15 now. I'll show you the chart. One second, I'll stop here.
Maybe I'll show you
one short video. And after showing this video, after seeing this video, again, you have to give me an answer. This teacher, whom you're going to see in the class, is going to empower her students. How does she succeed in empowering the students is one answer that you need to give me. And also, you need to carefully listen to what the teacher says on two or three occasions. She uses some very powerful sentences, very short sentences, but very powerful because, I mean, I'm talking to English teachers, I can give slightly difficult assignment. So what do you have to do? You have to carefully listen and identify the sentences that she uses. She uses very powerful sentences, right? At least get two sentences that the teacher uses. Okay, are you ready? I think you're ready. I'm going to play this. It's about 3.5 minutes. Please listen to this.
Today is my first day and I will be taking all your science subjects. So let's start off on a good note. Not that note, thank you. So let's start with a nice round of introductions. My name is Sakshi and I love working with young people.
Ma'am, my name is Anish. I was a topper last year. Ma'am, my IQ is 145 and I've got double promotion once.
My name is Andy. I like dancing.
My name is Jason and I like to play the guitar.
Okay, everyone's done except the last roll number. Zara? Where is Zara?
Zara is a zombie. 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 Zara is a
zombie. Class, set it down.
Zara is a zombie.
Gaurav, I'm gonna kill you.
Hi, how was your day?
You do know that's the name the rest of the school has given you, right? Every day, two students will come here and present anything that they are passionate about. There is only one rule. You must show respect. So who is courageous enough to accept the challenge?
Ma'am, anything?
Yes, anything.
My topic is everything you wanted to know about the birds and the bees,
but not afraid to ask.
Sequined in the night sky as the stars shine, they tell a million stories, some of yours and a few of mine.
By building a rocket. That balloon over there is also a rocket, but it does not go very far as it does not have any wings to give its flight a direction. So you see, in life, it is very important to have something
or someone.
Yes, or someone who can give you direction every time you're going astray.
It helps you go very far in life.
Good morning, class. Today, we have prepared a very interesting topic for the class. Today, I'm going to tell you about the physics of dance. But before that, my friend here is going to give you a small demo.
Class of Rowdy has really changed. How did you manage it?
I haven't done anything. I just created a space where no one is judging them.
Where they can learn through their own interests.
Hi class!
Good morning ma'am!
So everyone's done with their session except Zara. Zara, come on.
Zara! Zara!
Zara!
Is a voice waiting to be heard, wanting to be understood, wishing to be loved. Thank you, ma'am, for listening to us. Thank you for not giving up on us. Thank you for finding the reason for our rowdiness, for giving a channel to our craziness. Thank you, ma'am, for finding the poet in a zombie, for setting me free, for letting me be. No matter where we go and what we do, we always carry in our hearts a part of you. Dear ma'am, thank you.
Okay, that was the video that you... I would like some of you to comment on that. What was the transformation that was brought about? What was the empowerment that was given to the students? And how did this teacher manage to bring that transform? What were the powerful sentences that she used? What were the powerful words that she used? Some four or five of you can speak on that for a half a minute, 1 minute each. Whoever raises your hand, I'll unmute you and you can speak. Yeah, who would like to speak, please? Bellamkonda Rangayya, do you like to speak? You're already unmuted. No. Venkateshwarrao Dhatrika, do you like to speak? No. Kamalakshmi again. Kamalakshmi, I have unmuted you.
Sir, in the very introduction, she says it is her first day.
Mm-hmm.
Besides that, she showed her interest to work with the young people.
Mm-hmm.
That is one thing that shows her interest. And later,
could you hear the one sentence in which she addressed with a very particular name? What class did she call them? She gave them a name and she said that the whole school knows you by that name. Okay, anyone else?
Class of Rowdies. It is class of Rowdies. Rowdies.
Who said that? Who is that? May I know your name, please?
Suresh Kumar, sir.
Suresh Kumar, thank you very much. Suresh Kumar, thank you. Yeah, she calls them a class of rowdies. Why did she call them a class of rowdies? Any reason?
Because of their mischievous attitude.
Oh, is that all? Is that all? Or is that because they were all mischievous, she called them a class of rowdies, or was there any other purpose? I think some of you...
I think that could be the reason, sir.
Okay, that's one of the reasons. That certainly is one of the reasons, but maybe anything more than that. Venkata Ramana Gupta Jannala Gadda, would you like to speak?
Sir, they were hyperactive, sir.
Oh, yes. They were hyperactive, they were rowdicious. That's why she called them rowdies. But is there any other reason why she called them by that name? And she said, I am not calling you, the whole school is calling you.
They are not respectful to the teachers.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay, I think this was some kind of a challenge that she threw at them. She said, this is how you are known. Do you like to be known differently? It's up to you. So the whole world treats you as a class of rowdies. I don't know whether you are ashamed of it or proud of it or whatever is your attitude to that. Do you want to have a better image of yourself? So there was that undertone. So when she said you are a class of rowdies and the whole school treats you as that, it was a challenge that she threw at them. And she said that if you really want to change that image, there is something that you need to do. Okay, regarding that conversation between the other teacher, the first two teachers, first asked her, they laughed at her in the beginning, then they passed by that class and then they looked at it in appreciation. And the third time, when this teacher sat with the new teacher, Sakshi is the name of the teacher, she sat with that new teacher, she asked, what did you do? And what did this teacher's response was?
Sir, she said that she created a space for them.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks a lot. She said, I've done nothing. I just created anything. She said, anything. And I said, she further challenged them. Who has the courage to do that? And the most interesting, the most touching thing in the entire video was the way the teacher sat with that silent, diffident, shy, mute kind of a student. And then the whole class used to make fun of her at the beginning. In the beginning, everybody said Zara is a zombie, but later they all welcomed her by thumping the tables. So that transformation again became possible because the teacher went and sat beside her and then without too much intruding into her privacy, quietly, gave her that word of appreciation, wow, and then made some kind of very quiet friendship with her so that this girl also came out and then she said, hey, even a rowdy class has a voice. And when she read out that poem, the whole class appreciated. See, these little things make a huge difference to your classes also. Just see, where is that button that you need to press to bring out that creative spark that they have? The learning spark that they have. In the beginning, your principal also remarked, teachers usually complain that students don't come, students don't behave well, students are mischievous. So many other complaints we make. But if we know, see, the same students, the same class, and the other teachers also have been handling them differently, but one teacher made a difference. And you can be that teacher. Every one of us can be that teacher. Maybe in your own college, if there are 10 teachers, not all 10 teachers are accepted equally, no? So there must be something responsible, something that the teacher is responsible for, not only the students. So students are not attending my class because maybe there are 100 reasons, but 101st reason is I am perhaps not doing my job well. Maybe there is something that I can improve. Apart from the 100 reasons, of course, you know them. The students are by nature this, etc. But in addition to them, one more reason perhaps that can be added is maybe I am also responsible because some other teacher is getting more students. Some other teacher is getting more attendance. Some other teacher is getting more attention in their class. Some other teacher is performing better. So maybe I'm not able to do that. That's why I need to, you need not become frustrated with that. You can tell yourself by with this little analysis, where are the areas that you need to improve? So let me quickly move on and then I'm not going to spend much time. So your classes must be like this. This was a class that I held about a year ago. And then, class must be a lot of interaction must be there. Students must wait to listen to you. This is possible. I think all that you need is an attitudinal change, a methodological change, and also some tips and tricks of good teachers that you need to equip yourself with. Okay, so collaborative tools is pair work and group work. Do a lot of pair work in your group class, a lot of group work in your class. And then there are some techniques of doing that. I think you already perhaps know. Otherwise, you can have another class sometime and then you can learn them. Give good instructions in your class. The best instructions are simple, clear, easy to understand. And sometimes it may say, for instance, I played that audio to you. Before asking you to listen to that, I asked one of the students to repeat one of the teachers to repeat those instructions. What are you going to do? Why did I do that? So instructions need to be given best so that the students will not go wrong. Many times students do not perform the task, students do not participate well, students fail the exams, not because they don't know, but because the instructions are not clear. Many times the problem lies with me if something goes wrong. Okay? Simple questions, I actually wanted to share that also. Let me, if I have a minute, maybe I'll go here. Okay, this is one of the, I sent you an assignment, a pre-assignment yesterday. So some 47 people have responded to that. This was the Google form that was sent to you. I call it a pre-assignment. Why only 47 people responded? Out of the 260 people who registered and 120 people that attended this program today. So why only 47 responded? Who is responsible for that? Not the students. If there is anybody responsible for that, only I am responsible. How am I responsible if 80 people did not respond to that? How is the teacher responsible? The teacher is responsible because, I mean, I deliberately did that. I'll tell you, Dr. Narayan Murthy reminded me 2 days ago. And he told me, sir, you wanted to post an assignment, what happened? He called me yesterday morning, sir, do you like to give that assignment? I deliberately said, no, I'm not going to do it now. Let me see if I do it in the evening, how many people will see that? So I posted it late, I did not give you enough time. Then two, I did not make it very attractive. Maybe you could have just seen it and then you thought it was one more message. That there were so many teachers' day messages, right? Everybody was posting something relevant or irrelevant, and that's why perhaps it got ignored. Or maybe I did not give you any incentive. Suppose, okay, only those who score at least 50 marks, 20 marks, 2 marks, whatever like that. So we'll do this. So if the teacher had taken a little greater care of making that pre-assignment a little more impressive, perhaps the same would have been done by a few more people. I did not deliberately, of course, I'm telling you how things go wrong. Why it did not get your attention? Maybe I did not do anything to ensure that it got your attention. Of course, there were some people who genuinely had other engagements, other commitments, who did not take very seriously. But at least instead of 47, at least another 30, 40 people would have participated in this, in case I had taken more care about this. Then look at the answers. Some very basic things. These are the answers, an analysis of the answers. Take, for instance, this one. So her handwriting was, this is a so that construction. So only 59%, about 60% people answered this question correct. What I think this one perhaps was the easiest question. Of course, I gave you 16 questions in the quiz. The last 4 questions were not exactly quiz, but I just wanted to give you some kind of a pre-knowledge of what I was going to talk to you today. That was not exactly an assignment. That was some kind of an aptitude test. And also it was to help you appreciate my classmate. Those who did that know that. Okay, so this one was the easiest. Maybe leaving some non-English teachers who were there in the group. English teachers should have got it 100% right. But I don't know how many English teachers responded right or wrong. Let me not go into those details, but let me tell you, things go wrong if the instructions are bad. Things go wrong if the instructions are taken for granted. Okay, I said this, that's why it will happen. It will not happen. Okay, and when you are handling mistakes, handling corrections, you can handle some quite intelligent ways. For instance, that so that structure, no? You might have noticed that when I narrated that joke to you, I use that structure indirectly so that I am talking about a mistake that some participants are still making. Okay, then eliciting. So your class should be full of eliciting. You must get from your students as much as possible without directly telling them. Then lots of questions in the class, make it a habit. So your classes must be full of questions. Sometimes you need not even wait for answers, but if you ask questions, the advantage is the student's attention will be greater. Right? Okay, have you got my first point? Actually, I'm not waiting for the answer. Okay, shall we move on to the second one? Okay, I told you that there are 5 points in here. So where are we now? So I'm just asking questions like that. I've not waited for any rest. I'm not given too much time for them to answer me even. But once the sentence sounds a question, automatically the student's attention gets provoked. The students all think there is a question here. Their attention will be greater. So make it a habit to ask as many questions. Questions are not just, many teachers think that questions are only to assess where the students are, how many marks they've got, whether they've passed or failed. No. Questions serve 100 different purposes. The most important purpose is they'll help me analyze my own teaching. If students are failing in my examination, I must know that my teaching is bad. That's called the watchback effect. So it will speak on the quality of examination itself, the quality of the teacher, the quality of the teaching, the quality of the instruction that has happened. So if 60% of my students failed in an examination, what does it mean? It means that my teaching has not been effective. So there is something that needs repair, change, overhauling, modification. Right. So ask lots of questions. Right. Okay. Have some games in your class. Have some activities. Don't just be comfortable with a dry lecture. So, for instance, in my class, I've shown you 2 short videos today. I've asked you some questions. I've muted and unmuted you. Suppose it were a continuous 2.5 hours lecture. Would you have, I know many places where in the beginning there are 300 people. Now it started with 110, 120 and still there are 93 teachers participating. So why has it happened? Because perhaps, I mean, something has helped you retain your attention towards this. Okay, have a game, have an activity, have something happening in your class. Use a little technology. PowerPoint, of course, is the minimum that every teacher uses these days, but maybe you can use other technologies. Of course, this corona lockdown has helped us a lot. Many of us are comfortable with other technologies, virtual presentations, virtual classes, and you can continue learning them because the future lies there. I think even after this period is over, after the lockdown is lifted, still there'll be plenty of opportunity and plenty of scope for us to work in the virtual field. So these are another set of questions that help you assess yourself. Do I involve my students? Do I employ pair work and group work? Do I have some activities in my class? Are my instructions always clear and simple? Do I ask enough questions in my class? Do I realize that all my students are not alike? These questions, you should assess yourself. Every question, oh, I give myself 50 marks, 60 marks, 10 marks, 100 marks on this, etc. This will help you again. So finally, towards the end of it, before I come to the fourth part, which I'll finish in about 5 minutes. So the whole effort of good, effective language teachers is to make their classes as simple as possible. So simple, I have again an acronym for that, and then simplify your lessons, involve your students, motivate them, and appreciate their work whenever they do something good, whenever they give an answer, excellent, very good, something like that. Praise them and take the lead and lead them. So you become, I mean, not that kind of leadership. A class leader is, a teacher leader is one who sets a model to others, and then who deserves the respect of the students, and also takes the class along. And whenever necessary, entertain it again. It does not mean becoming a buffoon, but I mean keeping the class entertained and engaged. So by doing this, you will do away with that clutter, and you will simplify your class. Okay, finally, the last one. I told you that if I have some time, I'll go on to the fourth part of my presentation. That's some tools available. I'll not talk about too many. I'll just talk about one tool and stop there. So the tool that I've chosen to talk about today is ESLPOD.com. So will you please, in case you want, you can note it down or take a screenshot. I have chosen this because it addresses all the skills that I talked to you about, the four LSRW skills, grammar, pronunciation, punctuation, whatever. All those skills are taken care of. So everything is covered here, that's why. You can try it in greater detail after the class is over. So what happens here? So there is,
hearing is when you experience the sound wave.
Some exercises like this, the one that I'm showing you. So there are some audios which you can use directly with some comprehension exercises. And the text, suppose you are listening to something, audio, you can also have the text like it happens on the television. The text scrolls. Here also you can have the text scrolling for your students. In case the students are beginners, your students' English is really not good, and you are teaching them the basics of listening skills, maybe the text scrolls, or the first time they listen without the text, and the second time they are listening with the text, and you can regulate the speed of the text. So you can choose the pace at which you play, right? For instance, this is one.
Broccoli and avocado, slow down aging. This is breakingnewsenglish.com.
I'm stopping it here.
Help, maybe here.
I'm just telling you. So there are audios like this, and you can go to this breakingnewsenglish.com which you can use the audios directly.
Broccoli and avocado, slow down aging. This is breakingnewsenglish.com.
So whatever speed you want, at that speed you can play it so that your students are comfortable listening to that. And you can create lots of different kinds of exercises. You can change the font size. Suppose you are playing it in a large class, you can change the font so that the students can see it easy. And you can have all these kinds of exercises built ready-made. You don't have to do anything actually. Suppose you want to take this lesson to the classroom and use it. There are quizzes already built on that. There are more quizzes on that. There are listening exercises. There are dictation exercises. There are reading exercises and a lot more. So, I mean, instead of giving you lots of links and then flooding you with too many things, I just want to tell you that you have to explore on your own, right? So when if you go to Google, is a jungle. If you go there, in fact, there is so much that it's often distracting. You lose your path on the way. So that's why be very careful. Search and then find some good tools that you have. Recommend some good tools to your students. Some good apps and tools that they can learn directly on their own from. And you also, some teaching tools, you equip yourself with and then become comfortable with them. I think once you start doing that, I'm sure you have a great, great, great career as a teacher ahead. I think your own satisfaction levels change, your own commitment to your profession changes, and your happiness multiplies, most important, right? The final message that I would like to give you is, instead of teaching for the sake of students, don't worry whether they are passing or failing. Don't worry whether you have finished the syllabus are now. Don't worry whether the principal is happy with you or angry with you. Don't worry about the rest of the world. But you must be happy as a teacher. Yes, I've done something. Yes, I've been a successful teacher. So whatever you do, finally, if you get that satisfaction, all the rest of the things can be ignored. So enjoy being a teacher. Wish you a very, 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 very happy Teacher's Day today. And wish you a great career as a teacher in future from today onwards. Wish you all the best. Thank you so much. And now open forum. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask me. I'll be very happy to share my thoughts on your questions. Thank you. If you raise your hands, maybe either invite you to ask your question or maybe somebody will read out the questions. I think the chat box is here. Only people are just saying, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Appreciation can come later, but maybe now.
Sir, sir, I'm Ramalakshmi. Can I ask you a question, please, sir?
Please go ahead.
Sir, thank you very much for this insightful and informative session. And while listening to that session, I got a doubt. In this session, you have played an audio, sir. And before playing the audio itself, some questions are given. Sir, am I audible?
Yes, please go ahead.
So my doubt here is, so when questions are given before the audio, listeners will focus on getting answers to only those questions.
Right.
Suppose questions are given after the audio, would it be better? Which one would you suggest?
In case you just want to test their comprehension, you give the questions at the end of the program. But here you are trying to build a skill. What skill? The skill of listening. A listening skill. You are actually not interested in the answers.
Yeah.
See, suppose instead of five, somebody says four. Absolutely okay. Fine. I don't care. But has the student listened? So to ensure that the student is listening and to ensure that the student is searching for something, he's waiting for that answer. So he's paying great attention to that.
We know that you are a great teacher.
And to ensure that attention, we ask the questions first. So there are three parts to it. Part one, you give them the questions, which is the task.
Yeah.
Two, play the audio or read the text. Necessary. You don't need an audio equipment. You can read it yourself if your voice is good, if your pronunciation is good. Then third, check their comprehension.
Okay.
It's not an exam. Suppose you go to a TOEFL examination. Don't expect the questions to be given first.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Welcome. The next question, please. Somebody made a comment here, Sridhar, I think. He says that a facilitator is not a machine, too, like a computer. I don't get it. That's quite practical, sir, but I'm sorry to admit that. Situational variations vary. Facilitator is not a machine, like a computer. Yes, I agree with you. Yes, situations vary. Every situation is different. That's where the teacher's role becomes necessary. So the teacher, so that's why despite all the technological evolution that has happened, despite all the tools that are available to us, the teacher's role still cannot be substituted. The teacher has to be physically there to resolve lots of things. That's exactly why the different kinds of situations in which we have to have presence of mind, we have to apply our common sense and we have to react on the spot. And we have to find solutions suiting individual students, and we have to consider the various learning styles, etc., etc. Yes, you are right. There are lots of messages of appreciation, but I don't think there are any other questions. Any other hand raised? No. No other hands raised. I think Dr. Narayana Murthy, perhaps.
Sir. Sir, please, sir. Sir, there are some questions. One of the participants, Venkatramana Gupta, is asking, can we allow students to speak in Telugu in the classroom?
My suggestion is, please don't. However bad their English is, let them speak only in English. If necessary, you speak their tongue. If the teacher speaks Telugu, no harm is done. I mean, limited. Maybe out of 50 minutes class, suppose you speak Telugu for half a minute, 1 minute, or maybe one word you translate, one sentence you translate. There's no harm. But if the student is allowed to speak in Telugu, when will he learn English? The whole purpose is lost. The student should not be allowed to speak Telugu.
Sir, there is one more question from the same participant. How to evaluate their writing skills when they commit mistakes? I mean, when students commit mistakes.
Whether they are mistakes in writing or speaking or any other skill that you are teaching them, mistakes must not be handled in such a way that the student becomes diffident about himself, becomes insulted. So if you highlight the mistakes and if you tell the student that, I mean, this is the way your English is bad, I think that student will not come forward to participate in the game. So whenever students make mistakes, the best approach is, so you just keep all those mistakes in your mind and then consolidate them. And maybe at the end of the class, at the end of the session, or maybe all mistakes in one chunk. So maybe you can, without even taking the names of the students. So which student made which mistake, this is not relevant. Right? So you can just approach all the mistakes together and say, okay, many of you are making this mistake. Just imagine I told you about that, so that structure today. Suppose I told you, because the data is available with me, suppose I gave you the names of the teachers who made the mistake. And I told you, oh, you are English teachers, you don't even know how this so that structure works. How would you feel? But I did not take names and I consolidated. Oh, so 60% people gave this answer, right? So, I mean, I'm addressing the mistake, but at the same time, I'm not insulting anybody. That should be the approach.
So there is one more question. Can we encourage bilingual method?
Yes. That's what I think I already told you indirectly. The bilingual method is the teacher using two languages, not the student using two languages. So the bilingual method has been used for a very long time. I think it did not serve its purpose. Better methodologies have become available. And today, the most popular method is the communicative language teaching method, which is not bilingual. But there are people who believe that the bilingual method is useful and is productive. So especially in the content subjects, if you use the local language or a second language, perhaps it's okay. But personally, what I think is that because you again remember those four things, the environment, the only environment that the student has is my class. So that 40 minutes is when he is getting to listen to some English. The only 40 minutes that I have is the time when the student has a little opportunity to say one word in English, right? Or write one word in English. Even if that is last, what's the use? So preferably make it as much English as possible. Telugu or the local term, absolutely, if it is essential, okay. But personally, I would like you to avoid it.
There is one more question. Can we use the word associate instead of using the word facilitator?
I don't know what you mean by associate, but associate is a different category. You know, you are working for somebody else, or you are working under somebody else, or you are, I mean, supporting someone. That is an associate. So an associate is not a teacher. So associate professor is a designation. Associate professor is not your job. Associate is a designation, right? Maybe because of your salary and all that, you are given that designation. So what do you do in the class decides what's your job, what's your profession. So what do you do in the class? Do you teach? Do you tutor? Do you coach? Or do you facilitate? So if you, what you do in the class comes under this category. If you are facilitating a class, you are a facilitator, not an associate.
That's all about questions.
So, good afternoon, sir. Hello.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir. I'm a principal, Government Schools, Rawalpindi.
Okay.
So I would like to ask one question.
Right.
So how best the students can utilize the mobile phone optimally in order to learn English? Because everyone student is now, almost 90% of students are having mobile phones, and how best they can utilize them optimally to learn English?
Thank you. That's a brilliant question, that very, very relevant to today's needs. Yes, most students have mobile phones, most students have smartphones, and because Wi-Fi and data is dirt cheap in India, so many students can afford to have constant data on them, and that's why so the students must be encouraged to download some free apps on them. One of the ready examples is Hello English. So please make a note, Hello H-E-L-L-O English, E-N-G-L-I-S-H. Hello English is an excellent app.
Cool.
And most parts of it is free. Only advanced parts of it, advanced aspects of it are paid. So let the students take daily lessons on that. The lessons are very, very highly creatively created and very engagingly made and very impressively presented. And most importantly, I told you, they are free. So every student has his own app and then his own access. Whenever they are free, they can use that. Once they get use them, they are as they are like addictive, right? As addictive as any game, for instance. These days, students play a lot of games on that. But once students get a taste of this, they become equally addictive to them, and then I'm sure they will certainly become better users of English. I think there are lots of them. Really, 2-3 days ago, English and Foreign Languages University also launched an app for learners of English. So there are lots of apps. English, Hello English is the best that I've seen, but maybe you can have any. Encourage your students to use them.
Thank you, sir.
Hello.
Yes, please.
Hello. Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, I'm Shanti Prabha from Kadapa district, Pilivendala.
Mm.
So in our college, so many students are very rural background students. Sir, how do we teach them, sir?
That's what I think the whole presentation has been focused on that also. You know? So there is a problem. Can anybody solve that problem? Can you change their background? They are rural background. They are Telugu speaking. Their mother tongue is Telugu. Their parents are poor. Is there anything that you can do to change that situation? No, it's not the teacher's job. Somebody else has the responsibility. They are working on that. So your job is to teach whatever you are teaching in a better way so that your students learn English better.
Okay, okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Happy Teacher's Day, sir.
Thank you so much.
Hello. Sir, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sir, shall I go for further proceedings?
Yeah, please. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Sir, thank you very much, sir, for your marathon presentation. Your presentation is awesome, inspiring, and thought-provoking. It reflects your expertise and experience. I hope all the participants gained knowledge from your experience. Huh? I hope they all. I hope they all.